Call the member for Goldstein.
Well, thank you, Deputy Speaker. Deputy Speaker, it's wonderful to follow the member in his contribution to this debate. And, you know, there are many things, obviously, that are grown in the Northern Territory, in addition to the extractive industries, the arts, but critically, it seems that Northern Territory has become expert in the development of the aphrodisiac sector with some of the products that they are creating, and we celebrate their achievement and their contribution to the country, because in the end, I'm looking forward to the member bringing down slabs, trays of mangoes and Kensington Prides that we can all enjoy in this parliament, because it is a product I enjoy, as I'm sure many other members do as well. Unfortunately, there has been some misinformation included in the member's speech, particularly around the contribution or the claimed absence of a contribution from the Morrison government to sectors like the arts and cultural sectors, none of which were excluded from the JobKeeper subsidy. But if that would make him feel better to mislead the parliament, that is his choice. Because the only one sector for member of Lingiari was excluded from the JobKeeper subsidy?
Lingiari? Solomon.
Solomon. I apologise, the member for Solomon. The banks, they were the ones who were excluded. And in fact, if you're in the arts or cultural sector and you're employed by an employer, you were entitled to be able to access it exactly the same way as everybody else. But what the Media and Entertainment Arts Alliance and the unions went around did is deliberately misinform the cultural sector about the application of JobKeeper to insert their relevance, to give the Labor Party something to rail against, without actually understanding the practical solution. In fact, what we did, Deputy Speaker, is we made sure that we provided assistance, not just through the JobKeeper subsidy, but through all of the additional support through the JobSeeker regime to make sure that...
Excuse me, the member for Goldstein has the call. You're being disruptive, the member for Solomon. Could you please sit down, or you're raising a point of order? That's what I said. Is he raising a point of order? The member of Goldstein.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. The member for Solomon is not raising a point of order. He's just going on a bit of a gallivant and a bit of a rant, and that's okay. He is entitled to do so. I believe in free society, and I believe in free speech, and I am not, from time to time, without a capacity to make an occasional contribution to another member's speech as well. But in the end, we made sure not just that JobKeeper supported those people who were employed, but additional support was provided to those who needed to rely on JobSeeker through a critical time. In many cases, people found themselves unemployed through no fault of their own, and there was a near parity between the two when you factored in the different components of tax and everything else, and of course the other supplements that went with it. And that's what this government has been able to do at every stage throughout the COVID-19 recession. Is because of the prudence, because of the sense of responsibility that we took, not in the rainy days, but in the days leading up to it when the sun was shining. We looked at the challenges facing our country, said it is important to be prudent, it is important to be responsible, because we are only the custodians of taxpayers' money, and our objective has been to balance the budget, and we did, so that we could put ourselves in the best position should a rainy day come. And Deputy Speaker, a rainy day, tragically, did come. You know it, I know it, even the members of the opposition know it. And so it's a question about how you went into this crisis. And Australia went into this crisis better than most, for a number of reasons. On the health front, the biggest public health measure taken throughout this whole pandemic was the one introduced by the Commonwealth in closing our international borders and introducing a quarantine scheme for Australians arriving or returning home, and of course for those from overseas seeking to get to our country. We were not alone in that. Us, New Zealand, obviously being in comparative positions surrounded by ocean, has enabled us to keep the virus out. In fact, we've only had two big incidents really of the virus penetrating that border. The first, of course, was Ruby Princess in New South Wales, sadly because of failures at the New South Wales end, and of course the horrible consequences of the hotel quarantine scheme in Victoria, which has led to a mass outbreak in the great state, and of course the lockdown of it for many months, which has had a ruinous impact on people's lives and livelihoods. Now, we can all go on a long discussion about who's responsible, whatever else. As the Treasurer correctly said in Parliament today, that is a matter that is being investigated by an inquiry, and we expect that inquiry to do its full duty, its full responsibility, and ask every question to make sure that we get to the bottom of it, so that we can make sure these failings aren't repeated again, and to make sure that Victorians and Australians can have confidence in the security of their borders should we have further waves of this virus. Because I know, like many Victorians, how difficult this time has been. The lockdown has been punishing for so many people through no fault of their own. And the Treasurer was right today. Getting the case numbers down in Victoria is the victory of the Victorian people and no one else. And now we have a policy framework which seems to be built finally on trusting and respecting Victorians to do the right thing and not implementing punitive measures where people should be trusted and respected. But at every stage throughout this crisis, Deputy Speaker, the Commonwealth has had Victorians' backs. We have provided every bit of assistance we can on the health front, on the economic front, on the household front, on the individual front, on the mental health front. Wherever it has been, we have stood shoulder to shoulder, side by side with the great state to make sure that they can get through this stage. And now we pray and hope we are in the rebuilding stage, as much of the rest of the country has been now for many months. And this budget, under the Treasurer and the Prime Minister, is focused clearly on helping our great nation rebuild itself to build a sustainable footing, not just to resuscitate the economy of the 20th century, but to build the future of the Australian economy for the 21st century, so that the investment we make delivers the return so that we can have the jobs that Australians need today, tomorrow, and into the future. And in doing so, we have also cast an eye to make sure that the measures we introduce are temporary, though necessary, but that we also target the budget so that we can head it back to a trajectory of prudence and responsibility. Because that's what Liberal governments do. We take your money seriously. It is not our money. It comes from the hip pockets of Australians. And every time we take a dollar from the hip pocket of an Australian who's trying to get on with their lives, it is only because we see an advantage in how we can spend it collectively to the improvement of their welfare and the interests and the security of the nation. Any dollar more than that is an indulgence of the hubris of members in this place and in the other place. Because it says that we know more than you, and we don't. We have a better understanding about the challenges facing your kitchen table than you do. And that can only come from a position of arrogance. And that is why Labor budgets always seek to raid the hip pockets of Australians in the way that Liberal and National governments do not. Because they carry the arrogance of thinking they know best. They carry the arrogance of thinking that they can run households better than themselves without the information, without the proximity, without the localised context. And it's not just the households, it's citizens' lives, it's communities' lives, and it's the foundations of our great country that they're ignoring. And our focus in this budget is clear. What do we need to do to get Australians back into jobs, 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 jobs? And we do so not for some sort of esoteric reason. We do so because we know that jobs are the foundation of people's dignity, their independence, their capacity to be able to live out their lives, their ambitions, and realise their dreams and support themselves and their families. And can I tell you, Deputy Speaker, if we had a nation of 25, 26 million people who could all stand on their own two feet and be independent, that is a better nation than the alternative of empowering 600,000 bureaucrats in this city. And if you don't think that, I don't know, frankly, what members are doing here. Because we are elected to represent people, to empower them. And that's what every day my focus is as the member for Goldstein. What do we need to do to provide assistance and enable people to be able to live out their best selves? And in Goldstein, in the budget alone, we provided 75,700 taxpayers with relief this year so they could support themselves and their families. We made sure there was new investment through business cash flow, and the government's providing a temporary tax incentive that will allow 25,300 innovators in business to write off the full value of any eligible assets so they can bring cash flow forward, so they can be in a position not just to help their business, so they can go on and employ more and others, to build confidence and the strength of the economy of the nation. Of course, we've provided 8,100 businesses in Goldstein with JobKeeper to carry them through this period. The cash flow boost has helped 5,800 small and medium businesses. And of course, 5,300 Goldstein residents have received the Job Seeker supplement to carry them through this period too. We've also provided assistance to 10,957 pensioners in the community, and one of the first measures we took in the pandemic, one of the first, was to reduce the drawdown rate of self-funded retirees so they were able to conserve more of their capital while the market rebalanced. Because we get that no matter what stage of life you're at, that you need an income and you need surety and confidence. But the rebuild is where our focus now is, about what we need to do to deliver jobs, 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 jobs. And that's why a critical part of this budget is focused strategically on making sure that those young Australians who are in temporary work, who have found themselves unemployed, who have had their careers interrupted, or on the pathway to going into the workplace, we're going to provide assistance directly to those businesses to encourage them, to young people, to be employed. Because we do not want a lost generation, Deputy Speaker. We do not want young Australians growing up in a country where they don't think that their ambitions and their dreams can be realised. We want them to get a job so they can go on and form their own success, have a family, buy a house, and contribute towards the success of a nation, and be in a position to retire with dignity and confidence. This COVID-19 recession can be a moment that can destroy lives, or it can be one that provides us with an opportunity to build them. And we're focused on the building, and we should be focused on the building. That's why there's so much investment in skills, to make sure that if people need to restructure their lives or their employment or professional arrangements, they can do so, so they're not exposed to risks unnecessarily. But critically, we also understand, Deputy Speaker, that there are many people who aren't young who have faced adversity because of this pandemic. And the support for mature workers and encouraging them to be re-employed because of their skills, their knowledge, their capacity should be valued by employers, and they shouldn't be set back as well. At every stage throughout this pandemic, the Morrison government has had Australians' backs. And critically for the great state of Victoria, at this difficult time and over recent months, we have had their back. Now is the time for the nation to be able to stand up. And as the member for Solomon, to his credit, said, that we need the great state of Victoria and its economy to rev up to be part of the powerhouse of the engine of the economy of the nation. And that is what this budget is about.